Our purpose is to amuse. Simply to amuse. Nothing serious, nothing political.
From Daleks to Downing Street, never mind aliens, as the Whoniverse comes to iPlayer, we ask if Doctor Who has succumbed to an invasion of politics and social commentary.
If you're creating an imaginary world, at some level, it's going to reflect the world you live in.
Good evening. We start tonight, but Nick Watt. Now, tomorrow, BBC iPlayer will launch the Whoniverse, the ultimate collection of more than 800 Doctor Who episodes, documentaries, specials, plus a new series starring old Doctors and companions. It's all part of the programme's 60th anniversary celebrations. When the show was relaunched by Russell T. Davis in 2005, it enjoyed a standard of storytelling, character development and special effects its original run could only dream of. But not everyone has been happy about the Doctor's new adventures. Some have accused the programme of smuggling social commentary into its plot lines. A sign of the times, or was it ever thus? TV historian Toby Hadoke takes a trip into the Doctor's political past.
Monsters. Excitement. Running up and down corridors. Cybermen at St. Paul's. Yeti in the underground. Daleks in Westminster.
When Doctor Who started, the day after John F. Kennedy's assassination, it certainly hit the ground running. Lauding its high standards, the stage's Marjorie Norris correctly predicted that it would capture a much wider audience. But audiences are fickle things. Meaning? Well, never mind the time wars. We're talking about the culture wars.
Our purpose is to amuse. Simply to amuse. Nothing serious, nothing political.
Humans have flooded this planet with plastics that can't be fully broken down. So much so that you're ingesting microparticles whether you know it or not.
Some argue that the family entertainment show that sent us scurrying behind the sofa is now sullying itself with the dirty business of social commentary.
Doctor Who, like the BBC, has always reflected the philosophy and the values of the establishment of its time. In the past, that establishment was a little more small-c conservative. Today, it's politically correct. So it's no surprise to me that they are churning out a programme, like much of what else is on the BBC, that is really liberal left in its values.
This isn't what Doctor Who was like when we were younger. It was monsters and explosions and all that sort of thing. Wasn't it?
Look at them, Fifi.
In 2010, the tabloids were apoplectic when they were 22 years late in discovering that a young script editor, who talked about overthrowing the Conservative government during his job interview, had allowed a tyrannical parody of the Iron Lady onto the programme.
Why? For the good of the majority!
Andrew Cartmel went on Newsnight to explain himself.
The character was a take on Mrs. Thatcher, absolutely.
Take no prisoners.
I suppose one of the things that we did on my era of Who is that it did have a certain bite of reality to it, like a street-level reality, notably in Survival, which is set on council estates. And I think it's the way to go because social realism is the ideal backdrop for a science fiction fantasy story. But once you do start shooting in a recognisable London suburb, you are presented with the challenge of actually telling a story that operates in the real world. That arose particularly in Remembrance of the Daleks, set in London in the 1960s. The companion is going to look in the window of the boarding house and discover a sign that says no coloureds. I think this is rich and valuable social critique.
During the early 1970s, John Pertwee's Doctor was revelling in social commentary.
Segregation.
One story took on colonialism and apartheid.
Money for all of us!
In another, capitalist chemical waste is at odds with a bunch of hippies.
More muck! More devastation!
Never mind green issues, what about the Green Death? And then there's the planet Peladon, which tries to gain entry into the common market, sorry, Galactic Federation. But not everyone is on board.
I know the Federation's real intent.
Federation's real intent is to help you.
The same planet is later in the grip of a miners' strike.
The Federation told us things would be better.
I seek menace where there may be none.
And what about 1968's production team venting their fury on the peace movement?
Destroy!
By having a pacifist society put down by sadistic alien invaders. Whilst another writer used a story to fulminate about paying tax.
The taxes, I can't pay the taxes.
Oh, the taxes, my dear old thing. All you need is a wily accountant.
In fact, this was intended as a satire on the Labour Party's government, on taxes which were insane and out of control, and the villain in it looks not unlike Dennis Healy.
Listen to this.
And satire has long had a place in Doctor Who.
Then they have found massive weapons of destruction.
Capable of being deployed within 45 seconds.
What?
So, have Doctor Who writers just been reflecting the world they know?
Everybody run!
If you're creating an imaginary world, at some level, it's going to reflect the world you live in. I don't particularly think politics should be smuggled into to any kind of show. You're here to tell the truth as best you can and tell stories that are meaningful as best you can. How you vote is a very, very low resolution version of how you think, choosing one side or the other. I mean, if you did that, if you just smuggled politics in, as you put it, you'd be writing nothing but propaganda. And propaganda, even propaganda in a good cause, is always bad drama.
From the outset, Doctor Who was big on subtext. The Daleks, rooted in xenophobia and Nazism.
They're afraid of you because you're different from them.
While its second ever episode sees cavemen arguing over fire, a fable some see rooted in contemporary concerns about nuclear technology.
A social commentary has always been present in science fiction, but it's part of the palette. It's not supposed to be the dominant, overarching thing.
Science fiction does lend itself to parables and polemics, but I would say it's probably at its best when it's satirical.
No answer to a straight question. Typical politician.
The fact is, Doctor Who's politics were never easy to read. And you only have to dip into social media now to find people who think New Who isn't liberal enough. As always, it depends on who's doing the reading.
You can look at it any way you like, and I would say the Doctor is the best of everything, rather than one side or the other.
For Marjorie Norris of The Stage, that second episode featuring the cave people was, she said, a little disappointing. So there we have it. It took just 1 week for Doctor Who, television miracle, much-loved institution, cultural icon, to be not as good as it used to be. Doctors come and doctors go, but some things never change.
And that film was produced by Stuart Denman. That's it from us tonight. I'm back tomorrow. Good night.